If you're thinking of traveling solo, you have come to the right place today. I have been traveling the world solo since I was 17. I think it's 50 countries under my belt now. There's actually a video I made linked in the description below about all the places I've visited. If you're thinking of going traveling solo and it's making you nervous, just know that that is totally normal. In fact, even though I've traveled solo dozens of times, I still get a bit of trepidation before every single trip because there are so many questions playing on your mind, right? It feels like a first day in a new school. It feels like you might get lonely, you might not make friends, you might get sick and have nobody to take care of you. Anything could happen. But here is what actually happens. The second you get on that plane or that bus or that train taking you to your first destination, about half of your worries disappear immediately. As for the remaining 50%, let's tackle those now with my tips. My tip number one is packing light. Just for illustration purposes, this is what my backpack looks like currently. It's a 45 liter.
It's a 45 meter.
Liter. You really scared me. Come here. Oh, I hate it when you talk.
Let's see the rug.
Oh.
I'm going for a run, I can't see the rug. Yeah, very, very, very underwhelming.
Right, see ya.
He always does this. Where was I? It's a 45 liter backpack from Osprey. I've left the link below. It's super cool and sustainably produced. But the main reason why I purchased this one is that it is small and it challenges me to pack even lighter than I normally would. To be fair, packing light means different things for different people. I am 5'4" on a very good day in heels. So packing light for me genuinely needs to be quite light because here are things that I need to be able to do with my backpack. I need to be able to lift it. I need to be able to carry it comfortably for extended periods of time. I need to be confident that there is nothing in it that I couldn't bear to lose. And this is an important one. I travel with a fair bit of expensive equipment, like my DSLR that I'm currently filming this on, and my laptop, but I get them insured and they are not items of sentimental value. If you're not prepared to lose it, do not bring it because you won't have somebody with you who will be guarding your bags at all times. So you need to be prepared for like worst case scenario. My second tip is to bring copies of all your important documents. Make sure you have a screenshot or a physical copy of your passport, of all your insurance details. Make sure you have some next of kin details on you if somebody needs to contact them for whatever reason. And make sure you have backup debit or credit cards. My two debit cards of choice are Monzo and Revolut. And the reason why I like both of these is that they have very low charges whilst traveling abroad. And by the way, when you're traveling, do not put your cash in one place. Make sure you distribute it between different bags. Maybe put a tiny bit in your checked luggage, but not too much because in some countries, stuff might get lost from your suitcase. That definitely happens. But yeah, primarily have it on your person. And if you're feeling dorky, you can get one of those money belts. Tip number three is to make sure you have access to offline maps of the places you're traveling to. Grab your phone, open up the Google Maps app, click on your little face, offline maps, and then select your own map, and then pick the place you'll be traveling to. Where should we go today? Let's go, where are we? Uzbekistan. Here we go, zoom in on Samarkand. Beautiful city that I'd really like to visit. Download now, download again. Waiting for Wi-Fi connection. Okay, I'm sure you can figure out the rest. My Wi-Fi is so bad, which is ridiculous. I'm in central London. Offline maps will enable you to navigate around any city at any time, provided that your phone hasn't died. Speaking of which, always have a portable charger. Number four, get travel insurance. I know it seems like a needless expense, but you never know what may happen. Just look at the world around us nowadays, the COVID madness that has enveloped the globe. None of us could have seen that one coming, could we? Get travel insurance and make sure you have the right kind because doing different kinds of extreme sports, skiing, snowboarding, stuff like that requires extra coverage. I personally use World Nomads. I would highly recommend them. They're a great company and their link is in the description below. Also, a bit of a technical tip. Some governments have services whereby you can sign up for message or email alerts if something were to happen in that country whilst you're there. Number five is accommodation. And if you're traveling solo, accommodation might be the dividing line between feeling lonely on your travels or not feeling lonely. And the way I typically get around the loneliest issue is staying in hostels. Now, I'm 26 at the moment. I still feel very comfortable, very happy in hostels, but I have heard from a lot of my friends who have hit 30 that they're starting to maybe reconsider. However, I think there's still a lot to be said for staying in hostels, just maybe getting a private room, because hostels are centered around socializing. I'm not sure what the future holds for hostels. Doesn't look like we'll be staying in dorms anytime soon, but I do think that hopefully it will pick up by 2021, fingers crossed. You could also opt to stay locally, by which I mean homestays and Airbnbs directly run by local people. What you'll be doing by doing that is having a lot of fun, meeting locals, quite possibly eating a lot of delicious food, getting some insider knowledge, and this one's really important to me and I think a lot of you as well, supporting the local economy. Number six, overcoming loneliness. Now, maybe you've decided against staying in a hostel or a homestay, yet you still want to meet people, which is totally fair. A similar thing has happened to me quite a few times. For example, when I was traveling around East Africa, there just aren't that many hostels around. There are mainly just hotels, which can be quite anonymous, and you will not run into that many travelers in that way. What you can do is turn to social media. Personally, I have used my Instagram for this in the past, but I have the great benefit of having a lot of you guys following me so I can tap into that network. If you don't have that network, you can use Facebook groups, you can use different forums, meetup.com and websites like that, which are a great resource when you're traveling. Please know that you are much more likely to feel really socially drained while you're traveling from meeting too many people and having too many conversations, then you are the opposite. Tip number seven is don't drink too much. Ladies, you get me. A really horrible, annoying part of having all these bits apparently is that people will try and take advantage of you, okay? And it happens at home and it happens in other places around the world. I don't wanna overstate the dangers of travel at all, because having been to some supposedly super dangerous places, I have to say I felt very, very safe there. But do keep in mind that when you're traveling solo, no one is really looking out for you as much as they would be if you were with a group of friends. And whilst it's never anyone's fault if horrible things happen to them anywhere in the world, it is important that you be proactive and just make sure that you're being safe. So, bit of a mum moment, but I just want to reiterate this. Don't drink too much. Make sure you are safe wherever you are, whether you're on the road or just hitting up the club next door. I hope you don't live next to a club, by the way. That sounds like it would be super annoying. Number eight is don't be too flashy and don't be too visibly different. I know that can't be helped in certain countries by virtue of who you are and your ethnicity and stuff like that, but what I'm trying to say is don't make yourself look like an easy target. Listen, as much as I love Hawaiian shirts and socks and sandals, I will say this. If you try and blend in with the locals, you will A, have a nicer experience, you will have less staring, and you will most likely be safer. For example, if you're traveling to a conservative country, don't wear boob tubes, crop tops, and short shorts, because people will A, be kind of shocked by that, and B, they might pick you out as an easy target for different scams and things like that. And the other aspect of it is not wearing super flashy jewelry or waving your cash around. Not that you should be doing that anyway. Okay, Sam, I'll take the money back now. Thank you.
I'm a lover.
Yeah, that's great. Really funny joke. We've got the shot.
Can I have the... I'm a lover.
Number 9, just because you're traveling by yourself doesn't mean you have to do everything on your own. Organized tour groups exist and you don't need to join them before you go on your trip. You might also be able to find ones that happen on the ground. If you're staying in a hostel, quite often they have different tours that you can join. These organized tours, especially for young people, have a lot of other solo travelers on them. So they're a great way to meet other people, but they're also a great way to understand more of the local culture. Because let's be real, when you're traveling on your own, do you really get that much cultural context of, you know, what you're doing and seeing? Not necessarily. So taking a few guided tours here and there, meeting other people, especially locals, can be incredibly helpful and incredibly fun. My 10th tip is possibly my favorite that I'm gonna share with you today, and it is to keep your itinerary fluid. There are so many things to do in any given place that you are almost guaranteed to not have heard of until you actually get there. And the last thing you want is to be really eager to try some of them and not be able to because of time constraints. So make sure that you are being a bit laid back. It's easier for some personality types than others. I know there are a lot of people that love being organized. And there is a lot to be said for doing that, especially with, you know, flights and accommodation, getting good deals. But when it comes to activities, my advice would definitely be to keep it cool. Just, you know, go with the flow a bit. Number 11, go at your own pace. If you've never traveled solo before, maybe, just maybe, you shouldn't be diving headfirst into a year-long trip around the world. Maybe you should dip your foot in by traveling locally or just to your neighboring country. Starter destinations that are not too challenging to visit. For example, if you're American, you might want to go to the UK first or Canada or Australia because you can already speak the language. Or maybe you just want to start off with easy, laid-back trips to the beach, you know, go to Thailand, go to Costa Rica, instead of a full-on hiking trip in the wilderness somewhere. Wherever your comfort zone lies, don't, you know, take a giant leap outside of it if you're not ready to do that. Take that first baby step. Number 12, have fun and document it all. By which I don't mean having your phone or camera out at every given moment, because there is a lot to be said for living in the moment. And I think travel is really gonna teach you how to do that if you allow it to. But maybe at the end of every day, write down a few paragraphs in a travel journal. Maybe just call your friend or your parent, write them a message about the amazing things that you experienced that day, but make sure that those memories stay with you. Let me know in a comment below, what is your favorite part of traveling solo? Or if you've never done it, what's holding you back?